I'm audible?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to today's program hosted by Chamber of Advancement of Small and Medium Businesses. I would request everyone to mute yourself. If you have any question, please put it in the chat box. We'll have a Q&A session at the end. Now, I would like to welcome our president, Mr. Nilesh Lele, sir, to give a brief overview of today's session and also introduce our speaker. Over to you, sir.
Sure. Thank you very much. Just one second. Yeah, thank you very much, Diksha. A warm welcome to all our attendees today, and also welcome our guest speaker for the night, Dr. Sagar Gokhale, a very good friend. Before I introduce Dr. Sagar as well as hand it over to him, I would like to go over certain activities and introduce people who are attending here about our chamber. As the name suggests, our chamber works for advancement of small and medium businesses. We are headquartered out of Mumbai at BKC. We were founded in late 2020, in fact, December 2020, with an official launch on 1st March 2021. More details can be found on our website at casmb.org.in. And we are very much active on all our social media handles. And if you have missed any of our past webinars or other events, you can find it on our YouTube channel at CASMB India. Our chamber was formed with a mission to work closely with all stakeholders for the advancement of micro, small and medium businesses. We also have a vision where we want to make MSMEs all the more resilient and even more stronger, especially post-COVID, and make it a stronger backbone of Indian economy. As we all know, the importance of MSME, where it contributes almost 30% to Indian economy and more than 48% to the manufacturing export. At the same time, it also employs 11 crore people across India. On December 20th, Honorable Minister for MSME, Shri Nitinji Gadkari, has given us a further vision and a challenge to increase this contribution to the GDP from 30% to 40%. And the manufacturing export contribution from 48% to 60%. MSMEs are also expected to add another 5 crore jobs in next 5 years. So with these words of Honorable Minister, as a few of us like-minded people came together and founded this chamber during December at the height of pandemic COVID-19 with a single target in mind to empower the MSME entrepreneurs to achieve the next level of success. We have defined multiple objects, and these objects are increasing day by day. And we are working, just 1 second. Yeah, so we want to represent MSMEs in various forums. In fact, we have represented and given our inputs for the PLI scheme, the PMFME scheme in the food industry. Both of them should go live soon. We also want to empower farmers, introduce them to new technologies like we have done in last couple few weeks, where we have brought experts in the space of turmeric processing as well as jaggery processing. And we want the farmers to do value addition to their produce and think and become like entrepreneurs. We are trying to bring a convergence where there are different things happening across the country. There's academic research, academic institutes as well as research institutes working on new technologies. There are a lot of government schemes and policies that are getting announced on a daily basis. There is market available, there is export inquiries coming in. So we want the chamber to be a single point of contact where the convergence of all these stakeholders happen, where the startup entrepreneur or the MSME entrepreneur can get all the required things on a single platform. We also are helping SMEs develop different products which can cater to global markets through webinars such as today's and on a daily basis that we have done for last 2 months. We are trying to build capacity, trying to impart training as well as development to our MSME founders. We shortly post-COVID plan to conduct different study tours, come up with different strategic tie-ups, organize as well as help the startups and SMEs participate in exhibitions. We have been very fortunate that since being in existence for just over 2 months, we have had a very strong advisory board as well as a strong management team where our team members come with a wide expertise in this field of food, as well as finance, sales, marketing, entrepreneurship, acceleration, as well as incubation. We are also spread across 3 states already. Ms. Arpita is in Gujarat and Samir is in Goa, and shortly we'll be launching our MP unit as well. So we are very fortunate to have our footprints in 3 states, and hopefully we will be making an impact across the country. Through this webinar series, where we hosted them in the month of March and now in May, we launched few other initiatives in the month of April, which I'll also talk about. But through this webinar series, we are trying to impart different kind of knowledge. So on Mondays, we have our Entrepreneur Speaks, where different entrepreneurs from different fields talk about their success stories, talk about, I guess today we'll also learn a lot from failures. Sagar was mentioning, I would like to talk about my failures. I said, don't call it that way. Obviously, we learn a lot out of failures, but we try to bring different entrepreneurs who talk about their stories, their success stories. On Tuesdays, we are bringing experts who have spoke about different technologies. Last week, we had a fantastic speaker in Dr. Shivendu. Prior to that, we had Dr. Sanjay Bhoer, who spoke about novel enzyme-based processing of turmeric, and so on and so forth. If you have missed any of these webinars, feel free, as I said, to visit our YouTube channel. They are all uploaded up there. On Wednesdays, we have a weekly knowledge forum, and I'm very happy to announce that next week, especially, we will have an expert from Germany who's going to talk about different technologies that are available for small scale industry. And on Wednesday, and in fact on Friday also, we're going to have a session where we have an expert from US who will be joining us and talking about how entrepreneurs can create world-class products. So that's our aim through sessions on Wednesday. On Thursdays, we bring experts who speak on various topics in the field of finance. We have had experts talk about the Spurti scheme by KVIC. We have had experts from talk about Ministry of Food Processing Schemes, MSME, Ministry of MSME Schemes, and we are planning to bring someone who will talk about the PMFME as well as the PLI scheme that is being discussed and is in news in last couple of weeks. So just watch out for the sessions on this Thursday as well as the next Thursday. Through these webinars, the 23 webinars are already uploaded on YouTube, and we have had live audience of more than 2,000 people and more than 2,000 views on YouTube channel as well. As we speak, I think we have, I just checked a few minutes back, we have 676 YouTube subscribers to our channel. In the month of April, post the webinar initiative that we did in March, we got a lot of feedback, and we realized that webinars is okay, but there is a lot of other things, other help that our MSME and startup entrepreneurs need. And that's why we launched 4 initiatives, where the first one is the Startup Buddy program, where we are trying to mentor these startups, also help them build a network, help them connect to different professionals, especially. I'm sorry, I think I got disconnected. I guess many of us are facing this issue with the cyclone that's hitting parts of Maharashtra. So I was talking about, just 1 second. Yeah, so I was talking about the mentorship program. That we have started for startups as well as SME entrepreneurs. We also have started the Chamber Investor Network, where more than 15 pitches have been received, and some of them are in advanced stages of getting funded through the HNI network or angel investors or VC funds. We have also started our initiative where our chamber members meet once a month and they network with each other, and many times business gets transacted within our members as well. We have also launched the initiative for a buyer-seller meet for the first one is going to be for food industry, which will happen hopefully in the month of May, if not then in early June, where we are working on it and already have a few category managers of modern retail as well as exporters and distributors on board who will want to interact with sellers of various food products. And the fourth initiative, obviously the first one was the Buddy, Startup Buddy. Second one was the investor platform. Third is the buyer seller. And the fourth one that we launched in April was the industry defined problem, where companies or SMEs are sending in their problems that they're facing. And through a student competition similar to a Smart India Hackathon, we are trying to come up with solutions to these problems. And then we have also launched the Women's Cell and want to do activities specially targeted towards women entrepreneurs. Additional to all these events, if you're a member, obviously you can attend any of our events for free or for subsidized rate, or any of our partners that we have, where today we are being supported by four partners, including AFST Mumbai chapter, All India Food Processors Association, Entra O2, and NetProFan. So their events are also available either at a subsidized or free for any of our chamber members. And last but not the least, our chamber office in BKC in Mumbai is available for our chamber members for their team meetings or client meetings in case they don't have a presence in Mumbai. So some of the achievements over last 2-3 months that we have been in existence officially since March 1st. Like I said, we have more than 250 food startups part of our ecosystem, primarily through WhatsApp groups. Probably most of you are in those WhatsApp groups where we are helping them with whatever challenges they're facing, whether it's sales, marketing, funding, or compliances. They are being handheld and in most cases for free, and trying to help them to achieve the next level. 15 startups have pitched. In fact, the last two pitched today, just before this session. And like I said, some of them are in advanced stages in discussions of getting funded. Through the buyer seller meet, we envision that large business can actually happen. And that's our aim, where we want actual things to happen on the ground, not just, you know, create, just do all the talking and no walking on the ground. So that's what we are trying to do. And through the technology transfer, I know for sure that our dehydration session that we had with Lalit Maheshwari sir, or the turmeric processing with Sanjay Bhuhar sir, many people have actually reached out and they're in advanced stages of getting this technology transferred for their own setups that they want to do, primarily in the state of Maharashtra. We have tried to keep our membership fees as low as possible. And as per the categorization of micro, small, medium enterprises, it ranges from 2,500 onwards. So if you are having a turnover of up to 5 crore, your annual membership fee is going to be only 2,500 rupees. So if anybody has any questions about the chamber, feel free to reach out to me. My number and my email address is here, or to Diksha or Prajakta or any of the members that you saw in our management team, as well as our advisory board team. We are all available to help anybody who needs further guidance or inputs about the chamber activities. So with this, I take this opportunity to welcome and introduce a very good friend, a good person, and I'm sure everybody will enjoy listening to him, Dr. Sagar Gokhale. Sagar Gokhale has, for last 4 years almost, since September 2017, has been an entrepreneur and a co-founder of Ojman Food Bio, which is involved in manufacturing of herbal teas, dry mixes, fruit syrups, and mostly doing his business in a B2B as well as retail sector. Prior to that, he worked for General Mills for almost 5 years as a scientist too, and has worked on various of General Mills products, including the Pillsbury Atta and all that. He has also been a visiting lecturer at ICT, Institute of Chemical Technology, as well as University of Pune. As far as his academic background is concerned, he is a Bachelor of Engineering in Petrochemical Engineering from MIT. Post that, he did his M.Tech, as well as his PhD Tech from Institute of Chemical Technology. He has more than 11 research papers, many review papers, international conferences attended, and has also won many awards at General Mills and throughout his career. So with this, and of course, he's also working as honorary secretary of Jyotirvidya Parisanstha Pune, which is India's first amateur astronomers association. And he's very active in that space. So with this, I welcome Dr. Sagar Gokhale. Floor is all yours. You can present and take over from here on.
Thank you, Desh, for the wonderful intro and chamber as well. So good evening, everyone. Most our journey.
Your voice is a little low, doctor.
My screen is visible.
Not yet. Okay. One second.
Hello.
Yeah. One. Just one second.
Is that okay now?
Yeah. Now it's okay.
Okay. Great. Okay. So good evening, everyone. So I will be talking about our company Ozuru Bio, its journey in brief, and few of the learnings that in the last few years. Just a minute. Okay. So we started Ozman Food Bio company approximately 4 years back, and Amay Kulkarni and I, so we both are from UDCT or ICT now, Institute of Chemical Technology, and we started in 2017 officially in the operations. So as you can see, both of us have technical background, though I did in food technology. After I did classmates and during MTech only our wavelengths matched, and then only we decided that let's do something together. But after MTech, so we completed MTech in 2006, and after that Amay went for the job and I opted for PhD. But still at the back of our mind somewhere was there that we want to start something on our own, or we want to form a company, we want to manufacture something, because both of us are engineers, chemical engineers. So we had that passion that we want to manufacture something on our in our factory. So that was our passion, and that passion actually worked, and we came together, both of us. And then we formed this company, Ozman Food Bio. So Ozman, the name Ozman is a Sanskrit word for sun. So Oja means energy and Man means source. So source of energy is the meaning of Ozman. So that's sun. So sun is source of energy for entire earth. So all the operations on the earth, I will say, run because of the sun only. And that's what the name of sun we opted for our company. And since we had, both of us had a background of bioprocess technology as well as food technology, we wanted to work in both the areas, food and bio, or food biotechnology kind of areas. And that's why we named the company as Food Bio, Ozman Food Bio. So our company is self-funded. That means we didn't have any funding from angel investors or anything. We mostly it is our own funds or a little bit from a bank loan. We have a small scale processing unit at Pune, wherever we have multiple facilities. So I'll be talking about our journey, so you'll come to know what facilities we have at our unit. So at present, we are involved in B2B business mostly and contract manufacturing. We have small export business as well. We are exporting to UK, US, Australia, and New Zealand mainly at this stage. And we have a very small retail business as of today. Okay. So our vision is to make healthy, minimally processed, indigenous food and beverage products. So healthy is the important thing. We don't want to go with unhealthy foods or snack foods or etc. Even though we go for a snack food, we want to make healthy snacks. So we are working on healthy snacks as well right now. And we want to explore our traditional foods as well and give them some modern look and try to commercialize it. So whatever knowledge traditionally we have in India, mostly it is ultra local knowledge, and that's why it is not spread across India. So we want to dig that knowledge and introduce it to the entire world. So that's our vision, and we are working on it. Okay, so these are our present products. So mostly we are working in the area of herbal tea right now. It's B2B or contract manufacturing mostly. We are having multiple formulations of herbal tea, which we are manufacturing for someone, or few formulations we have developed on our own. So most of the teas are like green tea based, or green tea plus some flowers or some spices, etc. Then we have dehydrated products. So you can see a picture of dehydrated moog here. It's not a fresh sprouted moog. It is a dehydrated moog beans. So we have small business in B2B sector, like dehydrated vegetables or fruits, etc. Mostly whatever dehydrated products we are making right now, we are using them to make some nutritional mixes. And we are also exporting a few of the products to Australia and New Zealand. So these dehydrated sprouts, etc., mostly we are exporting them. And we also have dehydrated dry mix section. So we mostly do contract manufacturing for dehydrated dry mix. So I'll be talking more about that. Then we manufacture instant tea and coffee mixes. So like you might have looked, or you might have seen the products by Society Tea or Wagh Bakri, etc. So they are kind of single serve pouches of the tea and coffee mixes. So similar kind of mixes we make at our factory. It's all natural. That means we don't add any flavors, or we don't add any colors, preservatives, etc. These tea mixes, they are all natural, and we make in multiple flavors. So when I want to say flavors, those are flavors with the natural extracts, and we are not adding any synthetic flavor or even nature identical flavors. So they are available on Amazon and small retail business with the tea mixes, and mostly we are doing B2B business in the Pune and around region. So small companies, small offices, etc. Mostly after COVID pandemic, they don't want to get the tea from outside chaiwala or outside tea stall, etc. So what they want to do, and they also don't want to keep a separate person who will make some tea, fresh tea for in the office, etc. And that's why these instant tea mixes really picked up after COVID pandemic, and we are doing good progress in this front. Then we make a few syrups. So mostly they are for export. So we are exporting syrups to US, UK, Australia, New Zealand. And we are also making syrups for cold vending machines. And there we have B2B business. So mostly in Pune and around region, we are manufacturing different syrups for cold vending machines. And we have nutritional mixes, which are mostly dry vegetable based nutritional mixes, or dry fruit nutritional mixes. Dry fruits means mostly we are working in the area of working with the kokum. So kokum is mostly popular in Maharashtra region only, and we are drying kokum, making kokum powder, and making some nutritional mixes with the help of kokum, as well as we are making a couple of smoothie premixes, like different vegetable powders we take and add some spices, etc., and make a smoothie mix, which you can add to hot or even room temperature water and consume it. So people are consuming these smoothie mixes daily in the morning. So like you can see here, green smoothie premix or red smoothie premix. So those are developed for one of our customer, and we are doing contract manufacturing for them. Okay, so let me talk a little bit about how we started and how our company progressed. So both of us, Ameya and I, both of us are first generation entrepreneurs. We didn't had any background or any business background in our family. Our parents or even close relatives are not in business, and that's how we didn't had any background of business. But still, both of us had that passion that let's start our own business and do something. So that passion basically encouraged us to start something. Both of us, after post-graduation, that is after MTech or PhD, both of us had very stable job. We were earning good and our life was set. But still, we left the job and started this company. So that passion of starting business was behind that. And we left the stable lifestyle behind and entered into the challenging life where every day there is a new challenge when you run a business, and especially when you are running a factory, you have to manage workers, you have to manage machines, and you have to manage customers. Many things are there. So a lot many things we learned in this process. Earlier we were just doing office job, like Amey was working in the production area, mostly in vaccine and pharma biotech. So he was working in production, I was working in R&D, and we just had exposure to that section of the business only, and we didn't had the exposure to entire spectrum of the business, like all accounts we have to keep accounts ourselves, and we have to manage the workers, etc., etc. So a lot many things are there which we learned through our journey in last 4 years. And our major challenge was, since we didn't had any business background, we didn't had any experience in marketing and sales, etc., or we had not worked with those teams, both of us, and that was our major challenge. So sales and marketing, and I will talk more about that with our learning curve in one of my case studies. So let me introduce two terminologies here. So those who want to start new business, or they are or they want to start new venture, let me introduce the first concept, that is Ikigai. So that's a Japanese concept. So identify what are your strengths and what is the need of the world, etc. So like here you can see what are you good at. So identify your strengths, what you can do, what is your educational background, and identify the strengths. See what you love. So it's not necessary always that we take some education and we love that. Many times that is the situation, like I love engineering a lot and I studied engineering, but sometimes students don't have education which they really love. So because of the parents' pressure or because of the peer pressure, all my friends are going for engineering, so I am also going for engineering, although I love architecture or although I like literature, etc. So identify what is your love, and if your love and what is your good at, if you just intersect or have a common thing, then you will find what is your passion. Then identify what the world needs. Many times whatever you are good at, world don't want that. So you may be good in drawing engineering things on the paper, like engineering drawings or anything on the paper, but now world don't want that. World want everything on the AutoCAD. So even though you are good at drawing, now people or all the corporate companies or everybody is looking for computerized drawings, so AutoCAD. So you have to learn that. So many times it's not the thing that whatever you are good at and whatever you love is not what the world wants. And then see what you can earn from, so, or what you can be paid for. So if you get intersection of all the four things, that's called Ikigai. And that's the thing you should identify. What are your strengths? What you love? What are the needs of the market? What are the needs of the world? And how you can earn from all those things. So if you get intersection of all these things, then you'll succeed in life, or you'll do that thing continued for longer time. If you don't love that, maybe you will do it for 2-4 years and quit that. And you will not do it for maybe 20, 30, 50 years. So identify all these things and find out the intersection area of all those four things. Then another terminology which I wanted to introduce is SWOT analysis. So it is very important to do SWOT analysis before you start anything. And anything means it can be a new business or just a new project in your company or a new event you want to organize. So do SWOT analysis, that will help you. So identify the strengths, identify what are you are good at, identify your weaknesses as well. Identify the areas where you will you may fail in future or during the project or during the business, and be prepared for that. So identifying the weaknesses is also equally important along with the strength. Then find out opportunities. What are the opportunities in the market? So you start some business, but there is no opportunity in the market. There is not much market, or market is already flooded with the products and there is no more space for new product. Then there are possibilities of early failures. So find out what are the opportunities when you want to start business, and identify what can be the threats. What can be the challenges, or how you can fail during the project. So identify that and identify the threats, or threats from the competitors, threats from any other things, etc. So when we did SWOT analysis for both of us, Amey and I, we found that product development, R&D, production is our strength. Our weakness was, as I said, sales and marketing were our weakness. Opportunities, I will talk about how opportunity came to us and how we started our operations. And the threats were maybe our weaknesses were the threats, like because of we failed actually in some areas. Okay, so a little bit about our timeline, how we started. So after we completed our masters, as I said, both of us were like-minded and wanted to start something together. So in 2011, we were desperate that let's start something. So we did a lot of ideation, a lot of brainstorming in what area we can work, because I did PhD in foods and Amey was working in pharma biotech. So we little bit had different sectors, but so what are the areas where we can work, etc. So we did a lot of ideation, and you can see that although there was a spark, or there was a bonding with both of us since 2006 or even 2011, we started actual business in 2017 because we wanted to take some industrial experience. So after completing PhD, I wanted to work in corporates or the industry for some time to get to know how big companies work, what are the challenges, how is the global market, etc., etc. So after acquiring some industrial experience, we started in 2017. So in 2017, an opportunity came to us. Like one of our close friend, I will say, although he's much aged and he retired, but still I will say a good friend of us. So he wanted to close his unit. So he had small scale unit at Pune, in the area of food processing, and he wanted to close his unit, sell off everything and retire. So what we did is we just rented his entire unit so we said, let us continue with this rented unit for a couple of years and identify the challenging areas, identify the opportunities, make some connections, basically make some good friends in the industry, because we were working in bigger companies, so our contacts were in bigger companies, but small scale businesses is entirely different area than big companies. So let's make good connections. So we rented the entire unit, and few of his customers continued with us even we rented a unit, and they're still with us today. So basically we started with drying. So during my PhD, I worked on two areas, retorting and drying of vegetables. So these were the two areas which we were thinking strongly that we can work in this area, and we can basically start small scale business in that area. So we started with drying. He had a hot air dryer and some machinery which can be used for juices, etc. So basically in September 2017, we started the operations with mostly vegetable drying. Then in 2018, we launched our juices line, and I will be talking more about the juices line. And we also started exporting syrups and tea mixes in 2018. So we had good connections in UK and Australia, and we started the export immediately after we start in 2017. So we are still exporting syrups and tea mixes to UK, Australia, and we also now supply to US and New Zealand. Then in 2019, we set up a new unit. So the rented unit, which we were using since 2017, in 2019, we decided to set up a new unit. And now we have identified what are our strengths, what are our weaknesses, what products we can take further, what new products we can add, what are the new technologies, what are the limitations of the existing machinery, etc. And then we have entirely new setup in 2019. And we also changed drying technology in 2019. So I will be talking more about that. Then in 2019 only, we closed our juices vertical, and we started new line, which is herbal teas. 1920, we mostly stopped vegetable drying, and we started with ready-to-eat dry mixes, and we also started tea premixes line. And after COVID pandemic into 2020, we are exploring new ideas, and I'll be also talking the opportunities after the COVID pandemic. So that's the timeline, a brief timeline of our journey. So ready to serve beverages. So these were our products, and you can find very much similarity between our packaging and the paperboard packaging. So we had four flavors, kokum, solkadi, kari panna, and mango. And we had authentic recipes for all these four flavors. We made them with real fruits, or real fruit juices or fruit pulps, especially for mango fruit pulp. And we didn't add any synthetic or nature identical flavors. That was our basically key thing that we wanted to sell, that is made with real fruit juices and no flavors at all. And the spout pouch, the attractive presentation that we wanted to make with the spout pouch, it's much trendy, much attractive, and all those things. So we had these four flavors, and we launched them in 2018, summer of 2018. And as I said, we failed in this line, and we withdrawn all the products from the market, mostly in February 2020. And after that, pandemic came, and now we have entirely stopped our product, or I will not say stop, but we have paused. We have took a long pause on this line. So why we failed basically is the learning curve for us and maybe for many of you. Okay. So as I said, both of us didn't had any background in sales and marketing, and we both of us were from technology area only. So we had experience in production, we had experience in R&D. We developed a very good product, a nice product, but we failed to market our product. And that's why we failed. That's the main reason why we failed. And so we allocated lesser budget for marketing and sales. So whatever you invest for buying a machinery or whatever you invest for production, the same amount of investment you should do in marketing and sales. So many people don't clearly identify the difference between marketing and sales. So marketing is penetrating your product up to the customer, and sales is the sales you will do through the sales and dealer distribution chain. So marketing, so advertisement, reaching to the people, letting people know your product, everything comes under marketing. And sales is appointing distributors, appointing salesmen, and who will place your product on the shelf. That's the sales area. So we allocated much lesser budget for sales and marketing. That's the biggest mistake that we did. So we invested a much larger portion of our investment to buy new machinery for spout pouch filling. Heavy investment was done on packaging material. The spout pouch is rather costly as compared to bottles, and that's why much investment was done to buy those pouches, buy the machinery, etc. And compared to that, much lesser budget was allocated for marketing. We didn't appointed any marketing person. We didn't appointed marketing, sales person, etc. And we relied on mostly on third party marketing firms. So that was our mistake. So third party marketing firms are not closely associated with your product. So whatever efforts we have taken to develop our product and launch it, we know, and we have very close or we are closely related to that product, but third party marketing firms are not that closely related to your product. And that's why maybe they will not give the fullest to market your product. Then very less time we gave for packaging development, and there we got a lot of complaint about the packaging. Although we tried to identify a good manufacturer, we tried to do good packaging design, which looked beautiful on the paper, but when actually a pouch came and we filled the product in the pouch, you can see here in earlier picture, our brand name was Fruit Inspiration, but on the paper, it looked beautiful, the Fruit Inspiration written like this. But when we kept our pouch on the shelf, it was not that attractive. Or people have to search for the brand name. And mostly they used to call the juices with our company name, Ojman only. The Fruit Inspiration brand name was not at all catching the eye of customers. So first impression because of your brand name was not made because of this design. So that was one of the failure reasons. So we didn't pay attention to develop the packaging properly. We given much lesser time. Then incorrect launch time. So although beverages are mostly sold in summer season, we just launched our product in April. And April and May are the two main months when your product will be sold. But before that, customer should be aware about your product. And for the beverages, the correct time for the launch is November or December. So during winter season, although it's not a beverage season, you should place your product on the shelf. So people will keep on looking that product. And when summer will start after February, immediately your sales will pick up. So launching the product in April was a big mistake. And mostly, although May is also a month of the season, it's mostly people don't place much of the product on the shelf in the month of May. And whatever you have placed earlier till April, that is sold in month of May. And after June, when monsoon starts, immediately demand come down and your product will not move much. So that was incorrect launch time. Then incorrect positioning of the product. So our proposition was we didn't add any synthetic flavors. We made it with juices and real fruit juices, no added flavors, etc., etc. But the price point which people were looking at, so most of the people, when they called us for the inquiry, they used to ask, 10 rupaye wala mango drink hai kya aapke paas? So our cost point was 30-35 rupees for mango drink, but people wanted that 10 rupaye wala mango drink only. And they don't care whether you add real fruit juice or you are adding synthetic flavors, etc. So mass buying is on the basis of cost only. So we didn't place it correctly, and so the competition was not with the 10 rupee mango juice. So we have to place our product in kind of niche stores and A-class stores and malls, etc. And that was not done properly. We tried, of course, we tried for that, but it was not done properly. So the incorrect positioning and also the incorrect calculations for the margins, etc. So whatever your production cost plus your profit, whatever cost will come, your MRP should be just double of that. That's the thumb rule. So we didn't follow it very meticulously. And then when we wanted to place our product, then people were asking for more margin because we were new. We didn't have a marketing team. So people wanted more margin, or shopkeepers wanted more margin. And then we didn't have much profitability for our own product. And that was one of the reason for the failure. So do your costing correctly, identify the packaging cost, identify raw material cost, production cost, that is labor cost, energy cost, etc. Add your profit or add your margin, and whatever is the number you will get, your MRP should be double of that. So that mathematics collapsed, and that is one of the reason why we failed. So these are the main reasons that went wrong, and that's why finally we have to stop our product last year in January or February 2020. So that was a big learning curve for us. If we want to place our product in the retail market, it's altogether different game. It's not that easy. That was the learning for us, and we should have dedicated team for marketing, etc., etc. So with this, we'll come up in future again with our juices. That's our dream. Then second thing I want to talk about is ready to eat dry mixes. So just after we stopped our beverage section, or ready to drink, ready to serve beverages, we started with dry mixes and herbal teas. So these were the two new lines we started when we stopped the earlier business of juices and dry vegetables or vegetable powders, basically. So as I said, when we started our business in 2017, mostly we were working on dry vegetable powders, and we were supplying dry vegetable powders to So that was a B2B business, and we had hot air dryer during that time. So as I said, we rented one unit and we had hot air. The new technology that came up very fast was heat pump dryer, and we shifted from hot air dryer to new technology, heat pump dryer, when we set up a new unit in 2019. And heat pump dryer is a beautiful technology, I must say. It is not as best as freeze drying, but I can say next to freeze drying, we can get good quality of dehydrated products with heat pump dryer. The running cost is lesser, the investment is a little lesser, and running cost is almost 50%. Quality is very beautiful. Most of the time during drying period, your product do not go above 40 degrees Celsius, and that's why nutrients are retained good. Rehydration is good, because dry product you will not consume as it is. You will rehydrate and then consume. So you have to look at rehydration. So rehydration was good, nutritional quality was good, and that's why we shifted to heat pump dryer. We also shifted from vegetable drying to some value-added products like RTE dry mixes and nutritional dry mixes. So why we shifted from vegetable drying to this thing is because we had lower margin when we were just doing vegetable drying. And there are a lot of people in market who will do adulteration in pure vegetable powders and supply at whatever rate you want. So if you buy vegetables from market, no adulteration, pure vegetable powder. So let us take example of bottle gourd. So you cannot sell it at 120 rupees or 150 rupees, 180 rupees, but people are doing that. And this is because a lot of adulteration. And that's why we cannot compete with those people. And then finally, we said, this is our price point. We are not doing any adulteration. You want to buy, you can buy. Otherwise, you can buy from anywhere. And then steadily, we stopped doing that vegetable drying business. And also, we had dryer, which was of, say, 150 kg capacity. So initial load was 150 kg. So if you want to, say, complete order of 110 of vegetable powders, then we required a lot more time because of the scale. And then the profit margin was not that high. And that's why we stopped doing that. And we shifted to nutritional dry mixes, wherein because of the value addition, because of the positioning of the product as a nutritional product, we can get more margins. So that's why we made that shift. And we also started developing ready-to-eat dry mixes, like dry mix of misal or dry mix of pav bhaji, etc. So we started working with one of our customer who had a misal joint in Pune, and he wanted to open the franchises all over the Pune. So the challenge was to give the same taste in all the franchises or all the outlets. That was the challenge. And then he came to us, and we developed dry mix for his misal. And what people have to do at the franchisee is they just have to add hot water and serve the misal. So it's very simple. Cooking at the franchisee end was reduced, and thus this model we developed. So when we say RTE dry mixes, it's just add hot water kind of thing. So that's ready to eat, or it can be ready to cook, like gravy mixes, etc. So the gravies, which are the base for the vegetables that we get in restaurants, so like red gravy, green gravy, yellow gravy, etc. So we dry that gravy, and that is kind of ready to cook. So people have to just add hot water and add cooked vegetables so that it will be ready. Either vegetables or paneer or meat, etc. Like makhanwala is the gravy mix that we are drying. Then you can make paneer makhanwala, veg makhanwala, or chicken makhanwala, etc. Using the same gravy mix. Then you can also make breakfast mixes, gravy mixes, rice mixes, etc. In this area, that is ready to eat dry mixes. Okay, these are the photographs of our dehydrated sprouts, and these we are exporting right now. So we export different sprouts to mostly Australia and New Zealand, and now we are starting with US as well. So if we see about ready-to-eat market, then it's fast-growing market. So if you see in food sector, RT sector in entire food industry is the fastest growing segment in the food industry. So what are the growth drivers and what are the challenges? Let's have a look at it very quickly. So with fast lifestyle, with working women, mostly in urban area, people don't have time to cook entire meal at home. So what they want is ready solutions for their meal. So either it can be ready to cook or ready to eat. And that's why this market is growing fast. So we are offering them convenience. We are offering them at lower price point. People have high disposable income, mostly in urban area. And in earlier times, people had negative perception about ready to eat products, especially canned products, etc. Canned products are not good. They have a lot of preservatives and this and that. But since new generation is traveling across the globe, they are watching on TV, the food channels, etc., etc. So they are aware about these products and they want that convenience in their fast lifestyle. Also, the increase in food delivery apps. This is the new development in the last couple of years. And with the increase in these food delivery apps, the RTE and RTC products are picking up very fast. And what are the challenges? So there were a few cases of failed quality, especially with the case of retorted products or ready-to-eat products. This was the case. And then people developed that negative perception that these are not good products. And also there is perception like it is made maybe a month back or 4 months back. And if we make it fresh at our home or we order it from restaurant, it is a fresh food kind of thing. So that balance you have to do. Then increased health concerns. So ready food, ready to eat food is not a healthy food. That's the perception you have to break. Make some healthy ready to eat foods is the solution. Then lack of effective product distribution system is one challenge in India. So mostly these products are either sold online or through hyper stores or big stores, specialty stores, etc. So lack of effective distribution was a challenge. And then, as I said, restaurant versus packaged food. If you are buying a retorted food and the same thing, you can get it fresh from the restaurant. You will obviously compare, I am buying this ready-to-eat food, which was manufactured maybe month or 4 months back, and restaurant food is the fresh food which I can get. So, and also a price point. If you are selling at same price point, then obviously people will not buy. They will buy a fresh food made in restaurant. So you have to give some cost advantage. You have to give them convenience. Those all things you have to marry and present a product. Also, it should be nutritious. So the cost, convenience, negative perception, all these things you have to marry and present your product. Then a little bit of about COVID-19 pandemic. So after countries were locked down in last year, demand for RTE product increased a lot. So you can see here, Grofers reported 170% increase in RTE sector, out of which 31% was in ready meals and 41% in frozen food category. So people are working from home. They do, their children are also at home, so they don't have much time to spend in kitchen. They don't have much time in food preparation, so they are ordering ready meals. So if you can give them shelf-stable ready meals, that's the key area right now, or that's the emerging area right now. And this trend will continue even after lockdown is over, and eventually the market for ready-to-eat products will go on increasing. Also, I want to talk a little bit about restaurants. So after, so what happened during lockdown is the cooks who were working at restaurants, they went to their hometown and they settled there. They started something in their hometown only, and they didn't came back. So restaurants have this challenge after lockdown that they don't have the fixed cook. Even though there are some cooks right now working, they don't know if they continue to work with them, and they are worried more about their taste, etc. So they want to deliver continuous taste even though cook is changed. And how this can be solved, then they are coming to us, like they are asking for dry mixes of gravies, dry mixes of other vegetable preparations, etc. So that the recipe will be constant, even though cook is changed, taste will not change. And that's why they want these ready to cook or ready to eat solutions, restaurants also. So, and that's why we have experienced this in past 1 year, that restaurants are coming to us and asking for some dry mix solutions for them. So this is a new trend, and it will continue even further after lockdown also. So the possible products in dry mix categories are breakfast mixes like poha mix, upma mix, sabudana khichdi, misal, etc. Then gravy mixes, as I said, red gravy, yellow gravy, etc. Rice mixes, all kinds of rice mixes are possible, dal khichdi, biryani, pulao, etc., etc. All kinds of vegetable preparation, these are possible in dry mix areas or dry mix categories. So I think that's it from my side for today. So the take home message is, if you want to start new firm, new business, new project, do SWOT analysis or do Ikigai. These are the helping tools. Identify your strength, weaknesses, etc., etc. Make some mistakes. That there is no harm in making mistakes. That's a learning curve. So I say I have not done a MBA, and I have not spent crore rupees to do MBA, but I have spent few lakhs of rupees, and I learn in real time in my own business. So making mistake is this step for success, and identify the trends which are going in the market, and quickly try to develop some new areas where you can cater to the newly developing market. So these are the key things that I wanted to convey. Thank you very much for listening to me. If there are any questions, we can take. Let me see the chat box.
Yeah, Dr. Sagar, excellent session. I think there are a couple of questions where they have trying to understand how you cracked into the export market, especially.
Okay. So as I said, when we rented the unit, we got few connections which were from local market, and export market we cracked through connections only. So I know couple of cases where they wanted to crack some export market, and they traveled themselves to say US and UK, met the distributors there, and then. Oh, my video is not starting. Hello?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Just a minute. Okay.
Yeah, we can see you.
Okay. So the context is the key thing if you want to export, because you don't have, so when you are selling in local market, you can go and meet distributors, go and meet shopkeepers, do the marketing. But when you are exporting, you cannot go on daily basis or even monthly basis to your distributors, etc. So whoever is the importer is the key person for you, who will market your product and who will distribute your product in that country. So that is a key contact, and that comes through such connections only. So that's how all our export to all the countries we cracked, that's through our contacts only.
Okay. There's a question that was asked to me, but I would rather have you answer it. What percentage of MRP should you allocate to marketing and sales?
I think you are a better person to talk on that because we have already failed in that area.
I guess there's no right or wrong answer, but the big companies are spending 5%. So the likes of Hindustan Lever and all that, they are also spending 5% on their marketing and advertisement. So in fact, the smaller players should spend more than that. Unfortunately, yeah. We don't have the margins and we don't have the budgets, but I don't know what the magic number is, but you should be ready to spend minimum 10-20% of your turnover is what even I've learned through my ventures. Our budgets are 0%, unfortunately. That's where we struggle.
Yes, same is the case with us also. Okay.
There are a couple of other questions where someone is asking, do you feel spice mixes are challenging? Like rasam mixes, puli ogare mixes and all that?
Sorry, what was the question?
Spice mixes. Is there a market or is it a challenging area to be?
Yes, there is a lot of market for spice mixes, but for sambar mix or rasam mix, etc., there are already big players in the market. So identify something new. Even if you want to do spice mixes, identify something new. Like people are coming up with the spice mixes for various vegetable preparations or traditional preparations, etc., which are lacking in or which mostly big players don't go for because they are looking for a product which can be sold across the country. And that's why they go with the major spice mixes, which can be sold across the country. But if you are a small manufacturer, if you can identify the local spice mixes or the spice mixes for which are used in certain region of the country, like Goan type spice mixes, which we cannot get in Pune or like that. So you can identify such some special products and then you can do it. That's the thing which I wanted to share. Otherwise, there are very big players who will soon kill you if you go with the traditional like chaat masala or sambar masala kind of things.
What is your take on the future potential of dehydrated vegetables, especially export?
There is big export market actually for dehydrated vegetables. Actually, we didn't tap that market when we were doing vegetable dehydration. So especially, I think in Middle East countries or countries like Russia, etc., where they lack fresh produce because of the desert region. So there are a lot of opportunities for dehydrated vegetables also, but tapped that or we have never explored that opportunity.
Okay. There are a couple of questions which probably, I'm not sure if you want to answer, which is what is your turnover and what was your initial investment? Maybe you can give, I think your turnover is up to 5 CR is how you can disclose is what I feel. And yeah. What was your initial investment if you want to answer?
Our own investment was approximately 50 lakhs and we got some loan from bank.
Okay. And any quality and safety issues you faced?
Yes, actually, we since we don't have any in-house capability for quality testing, we spent a lot. Generally, this is challenge for all small-scale processors that we spend a lot on testing. So, testing is mandatory in food business. You have to do testing of your product once in a year at least, or once in 6 months for a few categories, like nutritional. For nutritional level, you have to do testing or safe for consumption testing once a year, etc. So actually we turn up spending a lot on these testings since we didn't had any in-house microbial things, etc. But there is no alternative to that, and you have to spend on those. Otherwise, there were not any much quality issues.
Any product recall you had?
Not product recall as such, but we had one situation, especially for export, that we exported one of our product and it caught fungus at their end. Fortunately, it was not on the shelf. It was still with the distributor, but it caught the fungus, and that was the challenging thing. We were fortunate that we escaped from that situation, and we took more measures on packaging, on our processing, etc. But that was the one thing.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe we'll take one last question. For RT product exports, what are licenses are required?
I think FSSI is the basic thing. Otherwise, apart from FSSI, you can get ISO or FSSC 22000. Mostly for export, they will ask for ISO 22000. So you can go for that. Or at least HACCP certification.
Okay. So I guess we are already over our time, though there's one question where Dr. Prasanna is asking that there are many products that are sold locally and they don't have follow food law and all that. So, but I will answer that question rather than putting Dr. Sagar on the spotlight, that there are some who are willful defaulters and there are some who are not aware of things. It's like, you know, to drive a car, you need a license, but there are so many people who drive cars without license. Something similar is here. Unfortunately, in our company, unless you are caught, you're not a thief or an offender. So they are lucky that they're still doing it, but sooner or later, I think the law will catch up with them. So it's definitely not something that is advisable, but if you and like even through our chamber or through AFSC, we do try to educate people that yes, if not license, at least registration. If you're under 12 lakhs annual turnover, at least get yourself registered. It's only 100 rupees per year registration cost for an FSSAI registration, and the document required are also hardly 4 documents, so it's doable if someone is really. And we can also guide without any charges. If someone is really wants to do good work, they should do it. If they're willful defaulter, unfortunately, I don't think there's anything you or I can do at this point in time. But sooner or later, the law will catch up with them. So hopefully I've answered your question. If not, feel free to reach out to me or Dr. Sagar or anybody in future. We are all available. Dr. Sagar's number, email also I've put. And my number was also displayed. Email address was also displayed at the when I finished my presentation. Yeah. Thank you very much. So, Diksha, can you please propose a formal vote of thanks?
Thank you, Sagar.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Sincerely, thank you to Dr. Sagar Gokhale, sir, for sharing your experience and also enlightening session. And thank you to our support partners, AFST Mumbai Chapter, EnterAuto, NetProFan, and AIFPA. Thanks to all the participants for attending today's webinar. I declare the session has ended. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.